Now, last week we were looking at how sharing shortens your season of struggle. When we started on struggle, I told you that struggle is proof that you have not yet been conquered. People shy away from struggle. They don't understand the nature of struggle. The nature of struggle is this. You may be tired of fighting. Battle may weary you. But struggle is still the proof that your enemy has not yet won. That's the nature of struggle. You're tired. You're weary. Sometimes it looks like the mountain you commanded to leave has not yet left. Well, as long as you keep commanding, it is proof that the mountain has not conquered you. As long as you keep commanding, it's proof that demons have not got the better of you. As long as you keep speaking, it is proof again that God is still in control of your life. So I told you that there are four definite things that you do that will shorten your season of struggle. Four forces. The first one is your speaking words of faith. To help you understand what speaking words of faith is like, I taught about it, and in the mercy of God, this book, The Secret Power of Speaking God's Word by Joyce Meyer, was placed for you at the table behind, and it still is there for you to take and make the best use of. How do you speak God's Word? How do you personalize Scripture? Is silent reading alone enough, or do you have to learn to speak God's word out? Well, it's important for you to understand that you speak words that affect your destiny. Shorten your period of struggle. Give you victory far quicker than you thought possible. Then number two, I told you your singing will create a climate that Satan cannot tolerate. What do you sing? Just any song? No. You focus on the song that you sing. You check for the content of the words that you sing about. A song without right content is as damaging as any other thing that you can think of. Sometimes these songs have melody attached to it. Some of them sound good. But you got to check for content to know what you're singing about. I'll give you an example. If you're singing a song that has words or lyrics that have to do with a postponement of something that God says is already yours, then at some place that song is going to work against you. I'm again repeating. Jesus says he's already given you love, but the song writer has given lyrics that keep making you ask God, give me love, give me love, give me love. In direct contradiction to Romans chapter 5 verses 1 and 5. I'm again giving you the scripture. Romans 5, 1 and 5 says, when the Holy Ghost came, the love of God came along with him. The Holy Ghost can't come and the love of God stay in heaven. Can I have an amen, please? So, Romans 5, 1 and 5 is a clear indication that love had already come with God the Holy Ghost. But somehow, if the songwriter was ignorant of this truth, and the words of the song were continuously talking about, give me more love, Lord. Give me more love, Lord. Well, the words of that song will work against you. How? Because you're going to always think you don't have love. The love of God is not yet given to you. And something supernatural must take place sometime in your life for that love to somehow manifest. There are many songs like that. Check for the content of songs. That's why sometimes in some churches they will even rewrite the stanza. Or they will avoid certain stanzas. Why? Because some of the stanzas were right to start off with. But then somehow along the way, the element of human influence came in. And the songwriter started putting in his own theology. And most often it contradicted what the Holy Ghost was giving. The Holy Ghost's words will always line up with scripture. So if you see songs with good melody, thank God for the melody. But I want you to find out what the content of the song is. So when you sing, you're singing words that will build you up, words that will edify you, and words that will shorten your season of struggle. It's good for you to sing songs that are word-based from the book of Psalms. And even then, to know what you're singing. Then number three, I told you, you're sharing. Sharing with an intercessor, sharing with a mentor. Who do you share with? Is it with everybody? No. You share with people who don't judge you and who don't act as busybodies in other men's affairs. Sometimes under the ploy of prayer, most people gossip. And it's quicker for you to understand that gossip can go under a religious garb as well. And for you to know who you're sharing your problems with matters. I thought about it last week. And I'm not going to go over it again. But I want you to know that sharing is sharing with not someone who judges you, but someone who is powerfully influenced by the Spirit of God and the Word of God. Such a person will understand that as a human being, you are imperfect and you need prayer. Now, the next thing is sharing with a mentor. We saw a couple of things, but most importantly, we looked at David. We looked and saw how Saul missed the best blessing of all by becoming an antagonizer of David rather than the mentor of David. He became a tormentor of David. He tormented David. He couldn't stand David's success. And it's terrible because David was anointed of God. Saul knew it. The others may have taken some time to understand it, but Saul knew it. And instead of rising up and becoming the mentor of this young man and being known as the mentor of the next king of Israel, Saul tormented David. He chased David from place to place. He did it not to see how fast David could be to escape from his hands, but he did it to kill David. He wanted to destroy David. Now there's something that I wrote about in the newsletter. For the month of October, I wrote in page 10 of the newsletter, the pulpit, never breathe life into something God is killing. Never kill something God is resurrecting. People have it in reverse in their lives. They don't understand what God is involved in and what God is not involved in. And when they operate in the wrong way and try to kill what God is breathing life into, then instead of the blessing, the curse attaches itself to them. And please listen, God is no respecter of persons. Can I have an amen, please? Saul was a man who was anointed of God. If God didn't believe in Saul and his leadership, God would never have chosen him in the first place. Yesterday I was talking to somebody about this. I said God had chosen Saul. And Saul had fought a couple of battles for the Lord and won. But somehow Saul never understood the anointing and how it works, and he never took time to find out from God God's plan for his life. He never saw himself as God's appointed king over Israel. Somewhere along the line, he wanted to be a people's king. Today you have a lot of people calling so and so the queen of hearts, the king of hearts. And you must understand, when God raises a man, sure, acceptance plays a high role in the person being in leadership. But along the line that God has drawn for the individual should never fail to understand that he or she was raised up by God for a purpose. And this is exactly what Mordecai warned Esther about. Esther was caught up in the purification ceremonies and so many things that were on in preparing her for the position of queenship. And in the midst of it, there was this horrible persecution that had started against the Jews. I want you to write down what I'm saying. I'm talking about things that pertain to what we're dealing with, about sharing to a mentor. What happened was this: caught up with the queenship and the anointing of being the queen, what took place was a supernatural release of holy boldness in Mordecai. Mordecai came, tried to meet with Esther, found out that she was busy with so much of work in the church, in the palace. But then he brought her attention to what was happening to the church of those days, so to speak, the Jews. He said, there's something that is on. And if you fail in your responsibility, she said, you don't know about protocol. Protocol dictates that if the king calls me, I can present myself. If he doesn't call me, I cannot present myself. I'll lose my life. Mordecai reminded her of something. That's what a mentor does. He said, don't get your eyes off the call of God on your life. If you're trying to think you can escape, remember your death will be postponed for some time only. But sooner or later, once the king has finished with the Jews outside, he's going to find out if any Jews are on the inside, and you'll get caught. But see the other side, he said. What if God has been the one who brought you to this position for a time such as this? And if you don't understand it, remember, deliverance will come. But you will not be the deliverer. So you've got to understand this in its right perspective. David was called of God. Saul didn't understand it. He thought he was called to be the tormentor of David. Over and over again, God was showing Saul, Saul, you can't touch this man. I've anointed him. I have called him. After you, he will reign. Remember what Saul spoke to Jonathan. He said, don't you see that as long as the son of Jesse is alive, you will not sit on the throne. I want you to write these things down, because people sometimes feel sad for Saul. You're going to understand that you never breathe life into something God is killing. When God had rejected Saul from being king, Samuel cried a whole night. God asked him, why are you crying? I told you I rejected the man. Now take your horn of oil and go. Can I have an amen from this church? Take your horn of oil and go. And anoint the son of Jesse. So you see, never breathe life into something God is killing. Never kill something God is resurrecting. That's equally important. So when you share with a mentor, like David did, in 1 Samuel chapter 19, he ran to Samuel. He told him all that Saul was doing to him. And Samuel took David along with him. And they traveled. And they stayed together. Can I have an amen, please? So David really came under the covering protection that was on Samuel. So what do you understand when you share? There is a covering protection on the church. There is a covering protection that is on the mentor. And when you come under that covering protection, you see the covering protection of God in operation in your life as well. Finally, the fourth force that will shorten your season of struggle. Is seed sowing. I'm again going to repeat, seed sowing. Sowing creates partnership with God. I want you to mark this down. Sowing creates partnership with God. Often people think that this is some gimmick that some American preacher thought of to raise funds. Wrong. It's a Bible truth. And if it's not a Bible truth, we have no business going with it. You can raise funds in a lot of ways. But when you talk about sowing, you're talking about something that's entirely biblical. And I want you to know that your seed sowing creates partnership with God that involves Him in your adversity. I'm going to show you something exciting from the book of Genesis. In the midst of adversity, in the midst of terrible situations, you can sow your way out with the help of God, because your sowing releases something with which God can work legitimately. I want you to write it down the way I'm saying it. Just write it down the way I'm saying it. If He works without you giving Him something, it's an illegitimate work. But when you give Him something, He legitimately becomes a partner with you. Legitimate. Genesis chapter 7, please. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 7. And we are going to read from verses 10 onwards. And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up and the windows of heaven were opened. I want you to write it down, please. How old was Noah when the floods came? 600th year of Noah's life. That's not a very good time period to have problems break loose. Now they say he was building the ark for so many years. So he must have started when he was about 500 years old. That again is not a very easy time period in a man's life to start building. Now he started building. Listen. For what? Not only because God told him something, but the act of building was a seed he was sowing to get him out of a problem that was going to break loose. I just want you to write it down. Because often people say, well, Noah listened to God and acted. God took the most unlikely candidate to build an ark. He was not a shipbuilder. And it must have been a terrible thing for this man to have the ark as his pulpit, because no one got saved listening to him preach either. For years he preached, nobody got saved. But you must know, for years he was sowing. Can I have an amen, please? Because when all hell breaks loose, your seed will see you through. Can I have an amen, please? When all hell breaks loose, your seed will see you through. I'm preaching under the anointing this morning. The devil has been mocking you, laughing at you, saying, what use has it been for all the years you have sown? My friends, Noah was a sower of seed for years before the floods came. He sowed before the floods. Now God would see him through the floods and do something later. Can I have an amen, please? It'll amaze you what I'm going to show you, because this thing which I'm going to show you, I have never preached about it earlier. You would never have heard me say this earlier. I came here this morning. I was seated here when the Spirit of God came upon me. And what I'm saying to you will see you through tough times. For years he sowed. What did he sow? He was telling people, the floods are coming. Who told him about the floods? God. What does the Bible say the word of God is? Seed. Can I have an amen, please? Can I have an amen, please? He was a seed sower. Sowing the word. Sowing the word. Sowing the word. Sowing the word. He said, God Almighty, I've never seen this. He said, that's why you need the Holy Ghost, to see things you have never seen before. You honor him, you will see things you have never seen before unfold before your eyes. That's why we honor him. That's why we love him. That's why we respect him. You heard our brother pray a little earlier. It must have sounded like loud talk. Yes, it's loud talk. If you have never talked loud to the Holy Ghost and made him feel loud, chances are you're not going to see much come out from God's word, because he's the author of the word. He's the author of the word. And unless he opens the eyes of our understanding, he's the one who brings light and life as the word goes forth. You and I will never see anything, my friends. we will be foolish people running loose in this world, depending on the arm of flesh to somehow put us over. But the arm of flesh will fail us. We dare not trust our own. I want you to write it down, please, the way I'm saying it. Because if you are humble enough to hear from God the Holy Ghost this morning, He'll teach you something. So what was Noah doing? Preaching the word. Preaching the word. Sowing the word. Sowing the word. Nothing happened. I said nothing happened. 100 years would go by. But as an act of faith, he was doing something as well. Building the ark. Building the ark. Nobody must have been there to help him. That's why it must have taken him that long. People must have said, you're a crank, you're a fool. What floods? We don't even know what you're talking about. All that we know is this dew that's watering the earth since the time of Adam. What is this thing called rain? What is this thing called floods? What's this thing called the deluge? What is this that you're talking about? He said, no, it's coming. God said it's coming. God said it's coming, and I'm building the ark. Now look, please. What happened in verse 11? In the 600th year, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up. The windows of heaven were opened. How did the deluge come? Not just from heaven. It came from earth as well. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. For the first time you read the word rain. Now you begin to see. God opened up two methods from which he would operate. From heaven and from earth. Why? Because there was a sower of seed on the earth. Can I have an amen, please? And I wish you'd write down what I'm saying. Don't play with what I'm saying. Sometimes it's far better you don't hear than to hear and not do anything about it. If God takes the extra step to teach us something, it's our bounden duty, our joy to listen, to take down, and to let the Lord open the eyes of our understanding. We begin to see why God says He'll bless us. Why God says, give and it shall be given back unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Shall who give to you? Men give to you. Why? Because when you give legitimately to God and give him seed in his hand, then God begins to legitimately work on your behalf on this earth and blesses your seed that you have sown. Two sources. So Noah gave God a legitimate opportunity to work on earth. In the selfsame day entered Noah and Shem and Ham and Japheth, the sons of Noah, and Noah's wife and the three wives of his sons with them into the ark. Follow in your Bible. They and every beast after his kind, and all the cattle after their kind, and every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. Creeping thing. Yes. God saved creeping thing as well. I don't hear an amen. But I thought it gives me the jitters. It didn't give God the jitters. to keep creeping thing alive. Can I have an amen, please, from this church? So it's time you began to grow and mature in the things of God. Come out of things that are making you feel queasy, creeping, and start walking by faith and not by sight. They were all in the ark. Nothing touched Noah and his wife who were seed sowers. There must have been snakes in the ark. There must have been other things in the ark. But nothing touched the man. I don't hear an amen. Amen. You sow seed, your seed will see you through your adversity. That's what, it's up to you to sow seed the right way. So, every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth after his kind, and every fowl after his kind, every bird after of every sort, of every wing, literally, of every kind. And they went in unto Noah into the ark, two and two of all flesh, wherein is the breath of life. Follow. They went in. Till now, no creature, listen, no creature ever just walked into Noah's house. Buffalo couple came. Ass couple came. Camel couple came. They came. I don't hear you. Why? Because like the other day when I said it, some creatures had enough sense to jump into the ark when human beings didn't. They came in. Two by two. It's an amazing statement. Why? Because that's how you will begin to see favor flow to you when you sow seed. They will come to you. They will say, we know that you are the only person whom God laid upon my heart to meet. Because when you pray, things happen. If you will come with me and you will stand with me, then things will happen in business. We have heard you're a good employee. We want you in our company. You're wondering who even spoke about me. It looked like all head had already broken loose. But here you will have people coming in. Coming in. And I listen. I am not joking this morning. I really am not joking. If you think I came here to play jokes with you, please forget it. I didn't. I know the kind of pressure I'm going through to even stand here this morning. I didn't. I came here because God wanted me here. And I came here to give you something of God's word. You grab a hold of it. You will see your life blessed and your children's lives and their children's lives blessed as well. Because to tell you the truth, I have never preached this earlier. I've been preaching for quite some time now. Those of you who have been in services where I've preached Noah earlier will never have heard me speak these things. Why? Because I didn't really know it. They came in. They went in. How? Male and flesh of all flesh. Male and female of all flesh, as God had commanded him. And the Lord shut him in. Mark that down, please. We have used this portion of scripture at various times to talk about how the door of salvation someday will be shut forever. And the arrogant who have never accepted Jesus into their hearts will be lost forever. But I wanted to say something. The Lord shut Noah in the cedar place of his protection against the adversity that was to be loosed on the earth. He shut him in. What God shuts, no man can open. When God opens, no man can shut. The Lord shut him in. And the flood was 40 days upon the earth. And the waters increased and bare up the ark, and it was lift up above the earth. Mark these scriptures down, please. The very adversity that came upon the earth made the ark float. Because seed sower was in the ark. Can I have an amen, please? The very adversity, the very problem that was drowning others helped Noah float. When your adversaries see you making it, to him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. Your adversaries see you. They are wondering, how on earth is the man making it? We thought he will wilt and fall, but he is making it. Because you are a seed sower, your seed will see you through your time of adversity. Write it down, please. Your seed will see you through. Your time of adversity. Put it like this. It may sound humorous, but just write it, because you can trust God to have a sense of humor. Seed sower floated. While non-seed sowers sank. Drowned. Seed sower floated. While non-seed sowers drowned. Or sank. Now you begin to understand why God says sow seed. You never sit and fool with a preacher who tells you sow seed. It's for your good. God's giving you one more opportunity to hear about seed sowing. Follow, please. The waters prevailed. Adversity prevailed. And were increased greatly. Adversity increased greatly upon where? Upon the earth. But somehow the seed sower not just escaped. The very adversity that caused others to sink and drown and kill them. Now, let the man float. You'll make it, my friends. You will just listen to the Holy Ghost this morning. He'll see you through thick and thin. You just give him seed to work with. Don't be dejected if nothing happens next week, next month. Just give him seed to work with. Because then you're giving him legitimately something to work with on earth. Legitimate. Legitimate. Look at verse 19. Did things just ease off? No. And the waters prevailed exceedingly. Now these are all words that you must pay attention to. That's why I have a highlighter. When you read your Bible, it'll show you that sometimes all hell breaks loose and it looks like the intensity of the heat is growing by the day. But if you will only give God seed in his hand, and you will just be faithful about it, then your seed will see you through, my friends. Because God will use the seed to work a miracle legitimately in your life that the world will never understand or know. 15 cubits upward did the waters prevail, and the mountains were covered. Mark that down. What covered the mountains was the waters. Completely covered. I wanted to see something. This adversity that came on earth killed. It's a sobering fact. What did it kill? Verse 21. And all flesh died that moved upon the earth, both of fowl and of cattle and of beasts and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth, and every man. All in whose nostrils was the breath of life of all that was in the dry land died. And of every living creature was destroyed which was upon the face of the ground, both man and cattle and the creeping things and the fowl of the heaven, they were destroyed from the earth. Listen. And Noah only remained alive. Seed has life in it. There's one amen. What about the rest? Seed has life in it. It doesn't look like it's got life in it when you hold it in your hand, but seed has life in it. If you want to just see how mustard can grow, just take a little bit of mustard seed in your hand and just take just maybe 1 inch or 2 inch of sand and just put it into the sand and just water it. Before the week is through, you will see beautiful little mustard plants springing out of that sand. And most people use it during Christmas time when they decorate their homes to have a small self-made lawn to add beauty to the decoration that enhances the spirit of joy and celebration during Christmas time. Now please listen, and listen good. Life is in the seed. Seed sower was alive when all the others died. Mark that down. And they that were with him in the ark, and the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days. Now how many of you are glad to be here this morning? You're going to see a little bit more in chapter 8. And God remembered Noah. God remembered seed sower. God remembered the preacher of his word, who preached in season and out of season. That's what I want you to see. In season and out of season, the man preached. Nobody got saved, but he just kept preaching. What did he preach? The deluge is coming. Who said so, Noah? God said so. Any takers? No sound. turns to see no one around. He looks a little bit further because he is on a perched position on the ark. He sees the same man and the woman who came and asked him the question, laughing, hitting the palm of their hand on their foreheads and pointing to no one, saying, the man's out of his mind. Now I wanted to see this. God remembered Noah. And every living thing and all the cattle that was with him in the ark. Mark that down as well. Everyone who went with the seed sower, God remembered. This is what I told you, there is an anointing in ministries, on churches, on men of God, on women of God. The quicker you understand it, the better you begin to see things happening in your life, my friends. Don't sit and attack ministries if you don't understand the anointing on them. Don't attack men of God or women of God if you don't understand the anointing on them. Because with them who go are saved and remembered by God. Sometimes certain ministries are anointed with a healing anointing. Some ministries are anointed supernaturally with an anointing that enhances finances. Why? Because God wants maybe that church or that ministry to fund a major part of what's happening all around the world. Then there are certain ministries in which you will have the revelation of God's word flowing like, I mean, it's amazing. Paul wrote most of the New Testament more than Peter wrote. Why? Because Paul was specifically anointed of God to make the mystery that was hidden known to the people of God. The mystery which was the church. So you'll know more about the church and what the church has when you read the letters of Paul. That doesn't mean that Peter was not anointed. No, Peter was anointed. But you got to understand the anointings. And the ones who go with them see a lot of things. Luke went with Paul. That's why we have the book of Acts recorded for us by Dr. Luke. I hear people this morning. He didn't write the book of Acts because he was a trained medical physician. He wrote it because he was a first-hand witness of the anointing that is on Paul supernaturally. And there was a revelation that came upon him by God the Holy Ghost to write about the book of Acts and to record the Gospel of Luke as well. So when you go with certain anointings, you must understand that you will begin to see a little bit more than you saw earlier. You'll begin to know a little bit more than you knew earlier. Don't walk in pride. Just recognize the anointing. Acknowledge the anointing. Yesterday when I was praying, I was talking to the Lord and saying, Lord, I am acknowledging the Joseph's anointing. I don't know much about it, but I know something. It will be a succorer of many, like you said it will. It'll be a provider for many, like you said it will. When you acknowledge and you begin to recognize who is the one who's doing it, who is the one who's making all these things possible, you will begin to see a supernatural increase come your way. When you read the scriptures, you will begin to see what you never saw earlier. It all happens when you go with the anointing, which is on the anointed ones. Mark that down, please. God remembered Noah and every living thing and all the cattle that was with him. And God made a wind to pass over the earth. That's where you begin to see God working supernaturally in the person of his spirit. He made a wind to pass over the earth, and the waters were assuaged. The fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped. The rain from heaven was restrained. What are we talking about? Harvest. Harvest! When did harvest begin? The moment God remembered the seed sower. And began to do something. What did he begin to do? Sent a wind to stop the adversity. When the enemy comes in, like a flood, the Spirit of God will raise up a standard against him. No wonder he's called Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner. How often do you use the names of God? How often have you called upon the name of God? Some don't. Some are so arrogant. It's pure arrogance in the church. When there's so much about the names of God mentioned and brought out by so many ministries that people never even take the time to find out about the names of God and the meanings of the names of God. They think it's just for the preachers. No, it's not for the preachers. It's for every believer. You need to know about Jehovah Nissi. Much like every preacher needs to know about Jehovah Nissi. Pure arrogance. When people don't respect the names of God. Now follow please. The waters return from off the earth continually. And after the end of the 150 days, the waters were abated. I want you to see something. After the end, rest came. And the ark rested. I don't hear an amen from this church. And the ark rested. After the end, in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, upon the mountains of Ararat. And the waters decreased continually. Till now they were increasing exceedingly. Now, step by step by step by step, decreasing of adversity. God doesn't act foolishly. He's a God of purpose and timing. He's a God of great grand design. Maybe the words I'm using are words that talk about the excellence of God. But you must understand that every language is limited in the usage of words to fully put in a capsule the excellence of God. Because he is far more than any language can describe him. You initially saw adversity increasing. Now you see adversity decreasing. Some people say, you're a lucky person. No, stop people and say, I'm a blessed man. Don't use the word luck. Get certain words out of your vocabulary fast. So that the words that God believes you must have on your lips will be the deciding factor on what things will happen in your life. It is not lady luck that brings blessing. It is God Almighty who's blesser, who remembers seed sown and then multiplies your seed sown and gives you the harvest that is blessed in your life. Your barakah doesn't come simply, my friends. It comes always according to God's timing. And the waters decrease continually. Until the 10th month, in the 10th month, on the first day of the month, where the tops of the mountains seen. What month is this? And it came to pass at the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made. And he sent forth a raven which went forth to and fro until the mountains were dried up from off the earth. And also he sent forth a dove from him to see if the waters were abated from off the face of the ground. But the dove found no rest for the sole of her feet. Why? You ever thought about it? Who was the seed sower? And she returned unto him into the ark, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth. Then he put forth his hand and took her and pulled her in unto him into the ark. The raven went, came back. How did the raven go and come to and fro? Who has the to and fro ministry? Read the book of Job. Satan, from where have you come? From walking to and fro on the earth. Up and down, to and fro. Restlessness. Restlessness. You see, some people all the time restless. The person is being tormented by a restless spirit. There is no rest. There is no calm. Restless. Send forth the dove. The dove could not find a place to rest its feet. It came back. And he stayed yet other 7 days. And again he sent forth the dove out of the ark. Now listen very carefully. All the while, the door was shut. This was through the window that he was doing all these things. And the dove came in into him in the evening, and lo, in the mouth was an olive leaf. Plucked off. So no one knew that the waters were abated from off the earth. I want you to see something. I told you your seed will see you through. When adversity came, death and destruction came along with it. But the seed sower saw a fresh plucked olive leaf in the mouth of the dove he sent. No one else saw it. Why? Because everybody else was dead. Only the inhabitants of the ark saw it. He stayed yet other 7 days and sent forth the dove, which returned not again unto him any more. Mark that down, please. And it came to pass in the 601st year, in the first month, the first day of the month, the waters were dried up from off the earth. And Noah removed the covering of the ark. And looked, and behold, the face of the ground was dry. And in the second month, on the 7th and 20th day of the month, was the earth dried. The ground was dry. Noah removed the covering of the ark. And God spake unto Noah, saying, go forth of the ark. The land was dry. Noah saw it, but he didn't jump off the ark. Seed sowers in times of harvest continue to be seed sowers for the next season of harvest. Thank you. The most foolish seed sowers who eat up their seed never get to see the next harvest come. He had preached in season and out of season. He had seen his seed see him through adversity. Now he was not about to do something stupid. He waited till the next word of the Lord came. Go forth of the ark. Thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. Bring forth with thee every living thing that is with thee of all flesh, both of fowl and of cattle and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Listen, that they may breed how abundantly. What did Jesus say in John's gospel? I came to give you life and life in abundance. Let them breed abundantly. In the earth, and be fruitful and multiply upon the earth. Now this is the master, creator of the principle of the seed, speaking in the midst of all the death and destruction, breeding abundantly. Be fruitful, multiplying upon the earth. What is he talking? Productivity. How is he bringing it to pass? By the spoken word. Not by thinking. Not by wishing in his spirit. By speaking. And Noah went forth, and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him. Every beast, every creeping thing, and every fowl whatsoever creepeth upon the earth after their kinds went forth out of the ark. Now listen. And Noah builded an altar unto the Lord. God didn't ask anything about altar. God did not speak anything about sacrifice. But no one knew that to get life back into an earth filled with death, he had to give first life. He had to first give life. He builded an altar unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. He didn't use creeping things. He didn't use anything that he believed God wouldn't accept. In fact, he gave the best to God. In gratitude for life spared, he built an altar and gave the best seed to God. As what? Burnt offering. Whenever you read about burnt offering, you understand just one thing. When burnt offering was given to, by any man to God, it always was given for acceptance. No part of the burnt offering would be spared. It would be completely charred. Look at verse 21. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake, for the imaginations of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite anymore every living thing or everything living as I have done. Now, when did God say the question? After he smelt something. When are you asked to give thanks to the Lord? When you pray and eat, you sanctify the meal. When the sweet smelling savor rises up in your nostrils, you don't dive into your plate. You lift up holy hands and say, Father, we thank you for this meal that you've given us. We ask you to bless and sanctify it, set it apart. Your grand provider, we recognize you, we honor you. And then when you eat, it becomes health to you. You see people diving into their plates? Some of them find it tough in life to later make it through a plate. Because they have this problem and they have that problem and they have this restriction and that restriction. Why? Because never have they ever taken time to give thanks to God and to sanctify the meal that he provided. It's a big bore to pray. Some people think it's a ritual. You invite a preacher home, he'll pray then. But when no one is around, we'll just dive into our plates and swim through the meal. Follow. This man brought the best to God and placed it as a burnt offering. The Bible says, and the Lord smelt a sweet savor, and the Lord said. And the Lord said in his heart, I'm not going to curse again the ground anymore for man's sake. And then he comes up with the best principle of all. The principle that we are talking about right now, seed sowing. He said, while the earth remaineth, first thing, seed time and harvest. Some preachers have taught on it like this, seed, time and harvest. Because there is a time frame between the seed planted and before the harvest for the seed you planted coming back to you. But it also means there is a time to sow. There is a time to reap. Seed time and harvest. Cold and heat. Summer and winter. Day and night shall not cease. Now I want you to see something before we close this morning. Because we are going to continue on this next week. When a child is born in the natural world, the child or the infant, for the most part of the child's life, sleeps. Eats, sleeps. Eats, sleeps. Eats, sleeps. Maybe goes through the function of releasing also what he or she has eaten. But that's not always. But the eating and sleeping goes on for quite some time. Till the child starts moving and, you know, whether it's crawling or actually walking as a toddler, the child just keeps moving between these two things, eating and sleeping. But in the midst of that, there's something that the parent tries to do. Regulate the child's understanding of two important time frames. Listen and write it down. Day and night. Sometimes you'll have mothers waking up the child in the evening. Others will say, if the child is feeling sleepy, let him sleep. They'll say, no, you don't know. If I let him sleep now, he will be awake the whole night. It's not because they are selfish. It's not because they didn't know about the BPO culture. It's just that much of life is ordered about these two time frames, day, night. So the regulation of the day and night takes place as parents teach the child day, night. But the child actually begins to understand day and night only as he or she grows up. The same with seed time and harvest. That's why we preach it. Not because we are after your money. Please listen. Most preachers know how to make it even without taking your money. Some of the people I've met over the years have already been successful, either businessmen or successful in their own fields of work before God called them into ministry, and they left all to follow Jesus. They know how to make it. They're not stupid, crazy characters whom God brought into the kingdom of God. No. They know how to live, and they know how to live well. But as people who are mentoring others, sometimes the regulation of these time frames must be taught over and over and over and over and over again. Don't you hear parents even today looking at a child and saying, enough, time up, off the lights. The child pleads, it's holiday time, can't I watch for some more time? They say, no, it's night and it's time for bed. You got to get up early in the morning and pray. You got to seek God's face early. The night has far gone. Why do people say, well, let's call it a day? And they rise up. Why? Because they know that the night is far spent. They need rest. And in the process of the maturity that they have, the children learn as well about day and night. You know what happens when you stay up one night, when you have not done it in a long time? The next day you feel drained. You don't even know why you feel drained. But you're breaking with the basic principle of the day and the night. Thank you. When people break with the principle of seed time and harvest, they are drained, but in a different way. Physically, you feel drained when you break with day and night. Look at BPO workers. We have a couple of them coming to our church. Some of them are fighting sleep in a service like this. They are apologetic about their behavior. They say, you don't know, Pastor, it's thrown all out of balance. We don't judge them. I want a loud amen, please. We don't judge them. We understand about the different shifting ways in which the economy of lands work. How work is being made available to people. But you must understand one thing. Somehow it affects the functioning of the person. The same with seed time and harvest. You don't believe in it. You misuse it. You abuse it. You don't consider seed time in any way an important ingredient in your Christian life. Then, like Bishop T.D. Jakes wrote in one of his booklets, sooner or later you're going to pay. When you claim you can't tithe, he writes in one of his books, most people don't understand that they anyhow pay the tithe. Only it's not to God any longer. It's to the mechanic. It's to the doctor. It's to the lawyer. It's to this man and that man who suddenly seems to jump into your life for no reason. And it's not a degradation of professions, please. We're not degrading any profession. We're not saying if people are tithers, they're never going to have a problem in the world. No, but what we are saying is this. When people tamper with the tithe, they end up paying it to the wrong person. They end up paying it to the wrong person. There are times when the ones who lead in prayer, when our main services start, pray for the tithe in the opening prayer itself. Some people will be all heated up when they start praying for, you know, something initially. Then all of a sudden they wonder, why is he praying that long? Now I know the attitude. Because as pastor I can sense the attitude of people from the pulpit. All of a sudden they remain silent. Now they're sitting and wondering, why on earth is he praying this long? Please listen. And listen good. When you read about the tithe, one of the first things that happens when the tithe is never recognized is that there is a premature attack on crop, premature attack on productivity, premature attack on fruitfulness. Have you ever seen it? Read the book of Malachi. Some people bring the tithe at the end of the month. They don't understand that the tithe is the Lord's and it's paid up front first. It's not after I go through the month. If I have the tithe in my hand, thank God for deliverance, I'll pay the tithe. No, you don't pay the tithe that way. Some people don't understand the principle of the tithe one bit and they're plain stupid. I'm again repeating, and I'll tell you something. I back the word I'm speaking. They're plain stupid. Sometimes people don't even understand how the tithe was paid in the Old Testament. They go through 3 months never tithing. 4 months never tithing. Then all of a sudden one day they'll come and say, well, we're going to pay the tithe. You don't understand it, my friends. Do you know the highest interest was paid not to Citibank? In the Old Testament, the highest interest was paid to any man who used the tithe. 22.5% was paid back to God. And people could go bankrupt just paying that interest on the tithe that was used. And people sit and mock the things about the tithe. They don't understand the way the tithe operates. The tithe is the Lord's. Can I have an amen, please? Just like you say that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the tithe is the Lord's. And with the tithe goes the offerings, which is the seed. I don't hear people. So the next time you hear Brother Anand lift up his voice and pray, you better say an amen when he's praying for the tithe and the offerings and the first fruits as well. He is not wasting his time praying. He is not seeking God's face early and coming here early just to waste time. He is coming here with a purpose. And he is bringing the attention of people back to what matters. Can I have an amen, please? What matters is prioritize your priorities right. Don't play foolish games with God. Nothing happened for over 100 years of seed sowing. But then the floods came. The man who sowed good seed made it. What about the others? They were also sowing seed. Seed of unbelief. Seeds of mockery and blasphemy. And adversity never let those seed sowers float. They sank. Stop playing games with seed sowing. If you want your life to be blessed and prosperous and to make it through adversity, because we have enough maturity to understand that as Christian believers, we will have to face up to some form of adversity or other. It will differ from person to person. It'll differ from person to person. It is adversity for someone who's staying Jehovah Rapha heals. to be led to pray for somebody who dies 24 hours later? You think it's easy? I said, you think it's easy ministry? You're praying for healing and someone dies, you've got to face the whole family. Especially if someone dies prematurely, it's awful. They're going to find out why you're preaching Jehovah Rapha. That's one form of adversity. But you've got to believe that in the midst of adversity, you keep preaching Jehovah Rapha. You keep preaching the God of miracles and signs and wonders. You were not called to find out whether he heals or not. You were only called to be a seed sower. You just sow seed. It was not Noah's business to find out whether the ark he was building for the first time. He was not a boat builder. He'd never built anything like the ark. He did it according to the specifications that God gave him. It was not his duty to find out whether the ark would float or not. His duty was just to build and to preach. Preach, build, preach, build, preach, build. Sow seed. The others also sowed seed. What harvest did they reap? Not life, death. Not freshness and newness, destruction. You don't have their names recorded in Bible for us. But you have the name of the seed sower recorded through the centuries for us to know that seed sowers made it. So the next time someone starts blabbering about the tithe and the offering, stop them. Or else just don't associate with such people. Such people are stupid people. They don't understand how productivity is hampered every step of the way because of wrong seeds that are being sown. And I've seen people talk a load of rubbish, load of filth. They attack this preacher, they attack that preacher. They talk about that church. They talk about this man. They say all that he's interested is making money. They don't know the principle of the seed or the principle of the harvest. It's seed, time, and harvest. You must also know one thing. While Noah was waiting for his harvest, there were others who were sowing bad seed who were thinking nothing will happen. But God's harvest is far bigger than the devil's harvest, my friends. Go with the harvest that God has planned for you. I'm meaning what I'm saying. Some people are plain proud. Time of, you know, opening prayer, they think, well, the man who's leading the prayers, you know, praying too long. Sometimes, who's he to pray for the tithe and the offering? I thought it's the pastor who's got to pray for it. Wrong. I said wrong again. He is asking God to bring the attention back of people to where it belongs. What is right? He doesn't even know what's happening, but I know as pastor what's happening. There are people who keep and play with the tithe for weeks on end because they don't have faith that if they give up front first, God's going to see them through the month. And in the last week, you'll see them putting the tithe. Not because they got their salaries in the last week. Please listen. Not because of that. It's because they want to keep payments first. You don't tamper with the tithe. I said you don't tamper with the tithe. You don't play with the tithe. 22.5% or 23.5% was paid as interest if a man touched the tithe in the Old Testament. Just think about it. If you didn't pay the tithe for 6 months, what kind of an interest you'd have to add and give to the house of God, not to the broker, not to the money lender, to God himself. No wonder the Jews are the best money lenders in the world, because they know how the tithe and the interest for the tithe that is touched works. Find it hard to believe? Go check up what I'm saying. Find out where the money in the world is held. With who? So the Jews. Most of them are top businessmen. They call the shots in most of the nations of the world. Some of them behind the scenes. Even in World War II, much of Germany's economy was run by the Jews. And it was the hatred of Satan expressed through Hitler, later even in Stalin's reign of terror in Russia, that was directed against the Jews, all because of wealth in their hands. And extreme levels of intelligence that God had blessed his old covenant people with. Can I have an amen from this church, please? And if God would do that much for the old covenant people, how much for new covenant folk in church? It's time you got the hold of the God of the Bible. You've been walking by tradition for years on end and never seeing the goodness of God the way God wants you to see it. Remember the very first word he said is, let them breed abundantly. He didn't just say let them breed as they wanted. No, he said let them breed abundantly. Abundant life. Abundant blessing. Abundant fruitfulness. Abundant productivity. And all of abundance was spoken to the seed sower. To the seed sower. We're going to pray this morning. I want you to hold your prayer requests in your hands, please. Your prayer points. Whatever you've written down, maybe you've been praying for 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks. Doesn't matter. Your prayer is seed you're sowing. Have your prayer points in your hands, please. And when you bow your knees before God, I want you to believe that God Almighty is going to hear your prayer and your prayer is going to be answered. Seed, time frame, harvest. It will come to pass. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Have your prayer points in your hands and begin to pray. Begin to pray. Begin to seek the face of God. Look to Him this morning. Forget about the one sitting next to you. Some of them may be dressed good, look good on the outside, but all of us have needs. I said all of us have needs. All of us have wants. All of us have desires. And the only book on the face of this earth that promises that these three different levels, needs, wants and desires will be met, granted and fulfilled, is the Bible, which is God's word to you, God's will to you. Have your prayer points in your hands and begin to pray. Even if it looks so impossible, remember your mountain that's standing in your way will move when you speak against it. Not sit and describe it. Nobody wants you to describe it. Nobody wants you to describe it. Nobody wants you to describe it. God wants you to speak against it. Speak against it in Jesus' name. Speak against it in Jesus' name. God doesn't want tourists explaining the mountain to him. He's not bothered about the height of the mountain or how long it's been. He wants administrators on this earth. People who will say what Jesus said. Speak against the mountain. Say, mountain, be removed and be thou cast into the midst of the sea. And not doubt in their heart, but believe that what they say will come to pass. Then Jesus said they can hear what they say. Hear what they say. It can be in private life. It can be in business. It can be in any area of life. Whatever you're commanding right now is seed you're sowing. Don't waste this time that God's given you. Sow good seed. Reap a rich harvest of blessing. A good harvest of blessing. In the mighty name of the Lord. In the mighty name of the Lord. In the mighty name of the Lord.